All religions, all this singing, one song. The differences are just illusion and vanity. The sun's light looks a little different on this wall than it does on that wall, and a lot different on this other one, but it's still one light. Today we have the honor to welcome the most venerable Arya Wangso, the chief monk of Thailand at National Management College. He's the abbot of Buddha Pujari Punchai Forest Monastery in Lampung. His honors and award include honorary doctorate of Indian Studies, Thammasat University, and Dharma Pratipaya Vayati Padra Nayaka Thiru of Siam, Sri Lanka. He has been in service of Dharma education, and MV disseminates Buddha Dharma to Europe, the United States of America, and Asia, giving Dharma discourse on the annual assembly of the Thai Sangha abroad, as well as to the Thai communities and non-Thai who are interested in Buddhism. He's invited as guest speakers and delegate to international conferences. He's a spiritual master and a chief guest giving remarks at several international conferences. He speaks on the topic of can religious interaction, that is Buddhism and Hinduism, lead to global peace? Buddhist science underlying paradigm shift towards equilibrium of life in pursuit of balanced well-being. He's reviving Magha Puja in different parts of the world. And he also goes on the rain retreat to various countries that include India, Nepal, and Pakistan. He's crucial in reviving the pilgrimage that was discontinued for the past 300 years. And he's staying in Pakistan for 3 months for the rain retreat. He has been very kind to contribute 60 million rupees for the flood victims. And he's also responsible for strengthening relationship with Mahayana in China, and he's author of over 100 items of publications. Over the past decade, he published regularly. Until present, there are at least 300 articles in Post Today's newspaper and over 200 articles in Thai Post. Now I invite most venerable to address the NMC 116. Thank you.
Blessing to all participants of the 116 National Management Course, the National School of Public Policy. Before begin, let me introduce myself. I have been invited by the Pakistan government through diplomatic channel between Foreign Affairs Ministry of Pakistan and Thailand. The purpose is to spend my retreat this year at Taxila, Kharara State in the former time, Chumbudawipa, now Punjab province, this in the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. This rain retreat is being conducted according to Buddhist discipline. During the 3 month rainy season, monks have to remain at a suitable place for Dhamma study and practice and fitting with their status. For this year, it is the period between July to October, ending October 10. With proper invitation, they are allowed to attend certain business, but have to be back at the residence with 7 days. So I am able to travel from Taxila and be here at the National School of Public Policy. I appreciate the vision of the directing staff, Ms. Umaira Sheikh Mafti, who went to see me Museum, the place offered by the Punjab government resident. They can be to come here and tell you the thesis of Kandara civilization in Pakistan. In connection with Buddhist world, a heritage site from the perspective of Buddhism. Today, I will share with you those experiences and the lesson I have learned. But please do not expect me to be much of an expert. The topic you suggested is Dhamma teaching of Buddha and Pakistan's role at the cradle of Kadara civilization. Some of you may be thinking of a course of comparative religion. You can relax. It is not a lecture on the teaching of Buddhism. But I will raise Dhamma principle of the truth existing in nature that can be proven by yourself and will be useful for building the body of intellectual knowledge to give an idea about pattern of work. So you can clearly determine what should be the role of Pakistan in the global society at the cradle of Kadara civilization. Before we can consider our role in anything, we need to study and understand the essence of that matter. Because we can consider our role in anything, we need to study and understand the essence of that matter. Today's topic begin with the words Dhamma, the teaching of Buddha. Many of you are already aware of the principle of Buddha Dhamma teaching, but that is not our focus today. I can tell you briefly in words of Dhamma that mankind through religion is the one with principle that make us understand the nature of life to develop our life, to have quality of a noble being. We can then conduct life with wisdom in order to bring our life, our society and environment to attain through peace and happiness by Dhamma. Dhamma, peace and happiness is the aim of all humanity. We religion being highly essential, that religion must have teaching that guide people toward peace and happiness of all mankind. A person may wish for peace and happiness, but it should happen for everyone, for society, nation, and the global community. This is the beauty of every religion that hopes to proclaim the principle of Dhamma teaching for mankind through peace and happiness. So it is most necessary that all of us understand the principle of Dhamma. What is Dhamma? A Buddhist will quickly tell you that Dhamma refers to teaching of the Buddha. That answer is not wrong, but it is not the direct answer. So what really is Dhamma? I will give you a universal meaning of the word Dhamma. It is the truth that exists normally in nature, such as birth, aging, sickness, and death. Everyone and everything arising in the world, we have to face that truth. It cannot be avoided. Dhamma is the law of truth that gives the same justice to everyone and everything equally. And what is most significant about this natural truth is the law of Dhamma or law of action. The heart of Dhamma is the principle displaying the truth of natural law that is important for every group of people in this world. It demonstrates the truth which can be proven as follow. All beings are the owner of their action. They must bear the reason of their action. All beings are born and their action related to their action, supported by their action, whatever actions they perform, good or evil, they must bear and resent. This is Dhamma principle that is the truth. Dhamma is the teaching principle for creation of knowledge and understanding proper with the truth of nature that will enable mankind to coexist with society and environment without being distorted from the truth, which could cause failure in the action of body, speed, or mind. Dhamma is about merit, goodness, and creative possibility for peace and happiness of everyone. When we combine the Pali word Araya, Araya, which meaning noble, with the word Dhamma, we have a new word, Arya Dhamma, translated as civilization. The meaning implies great beauty, which mankind should perceive the true meaning. With such beauty in their hearts, they have a noble mind, worthy of the noble status of human. Civilization has been defined as cultural possibility of mankind in each period. Civilization reflects every aspect of society progress in each period. So we use the word classes of civilization. We have to study civilization to utilize its value effectively by looking at the relationship to our present society, integrating it with the modern life. Education cannot step over each period civilization, especially when it has hidden energy strong enough to have impact on mankind in each particular period. Now, let's focus on the Indus or Sindhu civilization, one of the three early civilizations of the world, along with Mesopotamia and ancient Egypt. They are very important for the study of mankind history in all dimensions. Indus civilization or Sindhu civilization has played such a significant part in Pakistan world heritage. Most of its area is now in Pakistan, with a small part in Afghanistan and India. The Indus River flows through the length of Pakistan, with traces of civilization found in two large cities, Mohenjo-daro and Harappa. They include historical traces of Buddhist world heritage. They prosper immensely around 269 BE under the rule of King Ashoka. After the great king became a devotee, follower of Buddhism, numerous Chetiyas and Mahaviharas were constructed throughout his empire. During 277-288 BE, their traces still remain to be clearly witnessed. King Ashoka was a prominent patron for the spread of Buddhism within and outside Jambudvipa. In 290 BE, he invited Pramachantika Thera, he led a group of Buddhist monks to propagate Buddhism in the territories in Indus River Basin, with Gandhara and nearby region as the main destination. In 1308 BE, King Ashoka appointed his son, Prince Punala, as the viceroy ruling over Taxila Gandhara state. The evidence of this period is still present at Sikap World Heritage Site. During the third Buddhist century, the flourishing of Indus civilization related to Buddhism can be confirmed by a great number of archaeological evidences in the valley of Taxila, Pechawa, and Sawat. The progress of Buddhist civilization continued into the period of Kushana Empire in the time of King Kanisaka, a Buddhist devotee, becoming even more prosperous, especially from the 5th Buddhist century onward. In the 10th Buddhist century, it began to decline and ultimately disappeared in the 17th Buddhist century. Traces of Buddhist civilization overlapping each period of Indus civilization were discovered during the excavation conducted by the Indian Archaeological Survey more than 100 years ago. It was headed by Sir John Marshall, whose former house I am now spending my rain retreat. Every evening, as I sit down to write the manuscript for my Dhamma book, I can feel the real spirit of Indus civilization, particularly in prosperous period of Buddhism. The large number of artifacts in the wonderful museum of Taxila, Pechawa, and Sawat contain great value for people's spiritual awareness, especially Buddhists from more than 30 countries who wish to come and visit these sources of Buddhist civilization. This world heritage is mankind's precious spiritual treasure, and it belongs to the land of the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. Here are some of the questions. What can be done about the linkage to that world heritage civilization? And now, should we define the role of Pakistan regarding the precious treasure of Indus civilization? It is the issue for all of you to deliberate as owner of the country with world heritage site that have such spiritual value for the world. You have to consider the benefits that will lead to the development of life, society, and nation. Benefits to be derived from the knowledge and understanding of world heritage civilization of these lands of Pakistan. The suitable role in preserving the cradle of civilization can be laid out with knowledge and understanding of the following benefits of civilization. Facilitate decision making. One, in matter related to community and society in Pakistan. Two, provide perspective on the value of the ancient land with the complexity of civilization handed down to us, which retain energy that can impact the current movement. Three, build up knowledge and understanding of civilization and each period connected to society and the nation to analyze problems of those periods. This body of knowledge will be of great use in the movement of the present society. Four, able to lay out guidelines for the role and duty to proceed effectively, confirming with benefits from the cradle of civilization on this land, which will enhance the potential of national development in all aspects. However, these four benefits cannot be realized unless we truly understand the value of the cradle of civilization that has been declared world heritage, most of which are ancient sites related to Buddhism. I began today talk with Buddhist Dhamma principle, followed by the significance of world heritage civilization. A real appreciation of these two topics will be a key to open up your treasure of world heritage with Dhamma knowledge and understanding, which do not conflict with any religion, because everyone respects Dhamma peace, Dhamma knowledge and understanding will encourage cultural tourism that does not pollute local society and community. Dhamma knowledge and understanding will guide systematic arrangement of relationship, not causing damage to each other, especially on the spiritual or religious aspect. Dhamma knowledge and understanding will lead toward building peace with happiness for humanity with unity. When every party understands one another, respect each other, do not encroach, endanger, or bear any ill will toward each other, Dhamma knowledge and understanding will lead to familiarity as good friends, regardless of nationality and religion, leading to exchanging of wishes and loving kindness for another. It is said that nothing but knowledge and understanding can help us create the world of true peace. Consider Nepal as an example. Going back about 30 to 40 years ago, when political conflict was causing much unrest in the country, Lumbini area, birthplace of the Buddha, looked just like any rural farmland. But in the past decade, government effort had led to progress and developing the ancient site of Buddhist civilization. Lumbini was declared as UNESCO World Heritage in 2540 Buddhist era. Construction of international monasteries within the specified boundary was permitted. So with your rapid development, a new community rising up in the surrounding areas. Today, the peaceful and safe environment has brought in several million tourists for pilgrimage or sightseeing, and the largest number, more than 1 million per year, is from Thailand. Tourism business quickly grew with new jobs and income created, making the neighborhood richer and more vibrant. But importantly, it does not affect cultural tradition and religious belief of the local people, because the aim of this tourist to do pay homage to the Buddha birthplace, not to walk around local community for religious propagation. The growth rate of tourist business in India is even higher, with large number of people traveling to Buddhist holy sites, leading to expansion in many sectors. The Indian government gave priority to the promotion of tourism, related to Buddhist civilization without relying on UNESCO funding. That usually come with several conditions. Initially, the country received financial support from Japan for infrastructure connecting Buddhist and ancient site. Today, the expansion in India of the campaign for Buddhist civilization is directed at the entire world through every form of media and usually with diplomatic support. Pakistan has already shown increasing awareness to develop Buddhist civilization World Heritage Site to open up as destination for study tour and religious tourism of global Buddhists. This should be put at an ancient agenda with properly high standard and with emphasis on quality tourism, impact on local communities and society must be given top consideration since the character of Islamic society is rather different from society in India and Nepal. Tourism should be oriented toward the cradle of civilization, aiming to preserve and continue culture and tradition, carefully avoiding any conflict with religious practice in the community. The suitable form and pattern of tourism should be openly and clearly identified to proceed along Dhamma path, right with Dhamma. It will be possible if the government encourage of groups of Pakistan people, particularly government officials, to know the value of World Heritage Civilization on the land of Pakistan, probably with Dhamma. This will lead to cooperation with a correct understanding about the purpose of developing this cradle of civilization that has become World Heritage. Now, to sum up my talk today, it is most imperative that we study and understand the significance of the cradle of civilization, which is the national and global treasure. This will lead to the full and effective utilization for the systematic and orderly benefit, while keeping with the practice of local culture toward mutual benefit. We will then be able to lay out pattern of tourism conforming with the cultural part of the present society and preserving the identity of the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. It is important that Pakistan people play a role in getting to know and understand the tremendous value existing in their old cradle of civilization, and which has such influence on the spirit of humanity and global society, and the cradle of Indus civilization in the Kadara region. This still exists at the truth of Dhamma that have never been extinguished from the consciousness of mankind. Blessing all of you.